Hi guys, welcome to another session of RBI 24/7. My name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this new session. So I hope you guys are doing well. So guys, as you know that in this session, we discuss a set of 5 questions that can be of use to you if you are preparing for competitive exams. So let's not waste any time and move straight away to question number 1. But before doing that, I would like to ask you to subscribe to our channel. So if this is the first video of our channel that you are watching, then do not forget to hit the subscribe button, and pressing this bell icon is going to notify you whenever a new video comes up. You can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. So let's not waste any time. Here is your question 1, and this question says, GST rules have been tightened to curb tax evasion. According to the new rules, in case of businesses with sales of over 50 lakh a month, tax credit from raw materials and services could be used for only up to -% of the final tax liability. Okay, seems like a big and tricky question, but it is not, believe me. So the GST rules have been changed a little bit, and guys, if you remember, we have discussed terms like input tax credit in our previous sessions. So in simple terms, input tax credit is that portion of tax that you have paid on your raw materials. Basically, when you have purchased something, you have paid tax there, right? And now when you are making a sale, whatever you are earning on that sale amount, you have to pay some tax. So whatever you have paid on raw material or your purchases, you can deduct this amount from whatever tax you have to pay on your sales. So let's say you have to pay on your sales Y and you have paid X on raw materials. So your final tax liability comes out to be Y minus X, because you have paid this much of tax now. That is why this will get reduced from your final tax liability. So this is input tax credit, the amount you can use, right? So now government has fixed up a limit on this, and the correct option for the question is option E. Option E means 99%. That means, guys, let's say on your purchases, you have paid a tax of 3 lakh and on your sales, let's say you have made some purchases on which you have paid a tax of 3,50,000, right? And on sales, you have to pay a tax of, let's say, 3 lakh. So if before this announcement, you can see, since you have paid more tax than you are required to pay, so before this announcement, you did not have to pay any tax. But now this announcement is saying that you can only pay use 99% of your input tax credit. That means of this 3 lakh, you can only use 2,97,000 and rest 3,000. That means 1% of your tax liability you will have to pay as tax. See, earlier you were using 3 lakh out of this 3,50,000, and the rest 50,000 will be settled in the next period. But now you are only able to use 99% of your tax liability, and 1% you have to pay to the government. See, it is not getting waste, because now the amount that is going to get transferred, that means earlier you were using 50,000 in the next period, but now you will be using 50,000 plus 3,000, or you can say 3,50,000 minus 2,97,000, that is 53,000 in next period. So your claim is not going to get waste, the tax that you have paid, that is not going to get waste, but you have to pay 1% to the government as tax, right? So that is why you can only use 99% of the input tax credit for your final tax of your final tax liability, because your final tax liability is 3 lakh, right? Okay, here you can see, I think we have learned everything which is written here. We'll just run through it. Further tightened GST norms, right? There are some other measures that the government has taken. For example, Finance Ministry has halved the extent of tax credits that can be claimed by businesses where the vendors have not uploaded invoices to 5% of their eligible tax credit. So where tax invoices are not being uploaded by the vendors, earlier they could get an input tax credit of double of this amount, that is 10%, and now it is being halved to 5%, right? So this new threshold comes into force 1st January. Rules have also extended for the distinct goods can be transported with the day's validity. Basically, e-way bills are used to send goods from one place to another whenever you're making a sale. So there are some limits defined for it, and the rules have also been extended for this. So rules have extended the distance goods can be transported. So they are trying to make it easy for the vendor to sell their goods to a longer distance with using the same e-way bill. Accordingly, e-way bill will be valid from one day to transport 200 kilometers from 1st January instead of existing 100 kilometers. So the limit of distance has been doubled, right? And why is this being done? Why are they asking what to pay 1% tax? Because businesses, they use fake invoices in order to show that they have paid a lot of tax, and that is why they need not pay any tax now. So now they would have to pay at least 1% of it, and they would have to show invoices. So basically, to curb tax evasion, this has been done. Moving ahead to the next question. This is the second question for today. It says, following are some statements about will, select the ones which are correct. And the correct option for this question is option C. Option C means only one is correct. So this question talks about will. What is a will? A will is simply a document in which a person mentions that when that person will die, after that how the assets of that person are going to be apportioned among his friends and relatives. Basically, how that person wants the assets to be distributed among different entities, that is written in the will. That whether he wants to give it to his children or his spouse or to some charitable organization, all those things are mentioned in the will. So that is why this statement is correct. Useful only for wealthy people? This is not correct, because even for people who are not having too much money, a will is very useful, because they get to decide that how their assets are going to be managed after their death, right? So it is useful for everyone, at least who is having a significant for someone who is having financial assets, right? A will does not allow a person to recommend a guardian for their minor children. This is also incorrect, because a person can mention this in their will, that if they think that their children are quite young, they are minors, they are not adults, and they want a particular person to take care of their children after their death, they can mention it in the will. Here you can see some components of the will. Important component of estate planning. Estate planning, what is the meaning of estate planning? That how your estate, how your assets are going to be distributed or managed after the owner's death. So these are some things that the person can do using the will. Name an executor. Who is an executor? A person who manages these assets after the death of the person. Name guardians for kids. Decide how debts and taxes will be paid. Provide for pets. So if that dying person has some pets and that person wants that pets should be taken care after their death, then they can provide some amount for the maintenance of the pets. Serve as a backup to the living trust. So we have already discussed the meaning of living trust in one of our previous sessions, right? So the executor is responsible for liquidation and distribution of the deceased person's assets according to the will. An executor might get some fees or some remuneration for doing all these jobs. Moving ahead to the next question. So here is your third question for today, which says, dash is the term which is used for a legal process in which a will is reviewed to determine whether it is valid or authentic. So guys, if you remember, when we discussed about trust in the section of the testamentary trust, we discussed that when the trust is created after the death of a person, then it is important to prove the authenticity that the particular things or the particular activities are taking place in accordance with the wishes of the deceased person, right? So there is a process to it for this verification, and that process is called B, that is probate. The name of that particular process is probate, which is carried out for verification of the, in which verification of will takes place, right? It is decided whether it is authentic or not. Okay. So it refers to general administration of a deceased person, that whether, so first of all, deciding whether will is valid or not, and after that deciding whether things are taking place in accordance to will or not, that is probate. Involves collecting assets of the deceased person to pay any liabilities. First of all, the debts of the deceased persons are paid off. So if the person is having some unpaid loans, the assets are collected, money is raised out of them, and the debts are paid off. On the person's estate, to distribute the assets of the estate to beneficiaries. And after that, once the loans have been cleared, the assets are distributed to beneficiaries, right? And who is responsible for doing all this? The executor can file the will with the probate court. So basically, probate court is going to make the legal authentication of the authenticity of the will, right? So states can have different rules for time frame in which will must be filed after death. So see, after the death of a person, if you want to have a legal validation of the will, there has to be a time frame. Basically, law fixes a time frame that you can file will in the courts within that specific time frame, and that might differ from state to state or place to place. If a person dies without a will, he is said to have died intestate. Guys, if you remember, I told you that the grantor or the person who creates the trust is also known as a testator. But if this person dies without a will, he is said to have died intestate. So probate process for intestate estate includes distributing. See, the process is also same. Then also, if the person does not have a will, they are going to collect the assets, pay the debts off, and distribute the final to his legal heirs, right? But in this case, the probate may not be necessary because basically there is no will, there is no document of guidance, right? Moving ahead to the next question, and the next question says, what does it refer to here? Two statements given to you, you have to identify what does it refer to. And correct option for this question is D, that is reporting entity. See, any entity that is supposed to provide financial information about it to the public, so that the public or the investors can make decision in accordance of that, that particular entity is said to be a reporting entity. It is not necessary that they are companies. They can be other financial institutions as well. They can be charitable organizations, or they can be some non-profit organizations. So it is not necessary that they are companies, right? But it is important to get out financial information about them into the public. That is what the statement says, that they are supposed to prepare a general purpose financial report to gain an understanding of its financial position and performance, right? And this report helps users to make decisions on the basis of the financial data provided, right? Why are we discussing about it? Because recently, India's Financial Intelligence Unit, popularly known as FIU, okay, this FIU, it imposed a fine on one company which is really popular. You must have heard about it, PayPal. So it has imposed a fine on PayPal because FIU is saying that PayPal has not revealed its financial data, and it is very important for it to reveal it. Whereas they are saying that we do not qualify as a reporting entity. That is why we did not register into India as a reporting entity. and we are not we need not do that, right? As you can see here, so users of these reports can be anyone, shareholders, members, employees, right? See, case comes out from company's failure to register itself in India as a reporting entity because it is supposed to do it. And if it did, then it would have to come out with its financial transactions. Now, what did the company say? PayPal said that we do not qualify to register as a reporting entity because it is just operating as a payment intermediary. It did not fit into the definition of a reporting entity. Right? So basically, there is a gray area. This brings out a gray area in Indian law that policymakers need to work upon, that whether to make amendments in the criteria which has been defined for reporting entities or not. Right? Moving ahead to the next question. So this is the last question for today, which says dash is a slang term which refers to seed capital that has been extended by family or friends to an entrepreneur to start a business venture. Simple enough. Correct option for this question is option D. Option D means love money. So what is the meaning of this term love money? See, you can guess from its name. The love here refers to the family and friends who are willing to fund the startup of a person, right? And what does this tell you about the startup or the entrepreneurial venture that is going to get started? That it might not be eligible to get bank loans. That is why the entrepreneur has turned to the family for funding. And out, see, the family is not going to make decisions on the basis of financial performance or the presentation that the entrepreneur shows to their family. In most of the cases, the family might not understand, might not even understand the idea, or might not even be concerned with the financial performance. But they just give money to the entrepreneurs out of love for their beloved person, right? So startups that take money, so they do not fit into the requirement of traditional financing. Probably banks and financial institutions are not lending to them. That is why they had to resort to family. Decision to lend money and the terms of the agreement are usually based on the relationship between two parties. So basically, what is the relationship? Not financial relationship, but family relationships. So it is more like based upon, just as we talk about relationship banking, some similar concept is applied here. See, it is very important here for the entrepreneur and the investors who are putting their money into this venture to look at the financial aspect as well, keeping the emotional biases aside, because it might be a really risky venture, and because of the love, because of the emotional bias, they might not realize this, right? So capital changing hands, this should be done with proper analysis. Should be made only with capital if investors are prepared to lose it entirely, because there is no insurance, there is no guarantee that the money is going to come back. So if the family is properly prepared to lose the money, then only they should invest, as it does not have any fixed repayment and you cannot expect a regular return on that money that you are investing into your person's venture. Love money may also be advanced as a loan or a convertible note with a more formal and structured agreement. So it can be in the form of a more structured agreement that is beneficial for both investors and the entrepreneur, right? So this was about love money. So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. If you did, then do not forget to hit the like button, because I'll be back in next session with some new information. So till then, take care of yourselves. Keep your studies going on. Keep reading the newspapers, and I'll see you in the next session. Thank you for being here.